This video is part one in a series about Super Nintendo Entertainment System features. We'll be introducing the various graphics formats, as well as palettes and how they're used to assign colors to the graphics. Suppose we have an image that we want to store on our console. How can we represent this two-dimensional image as a one-dimensional stream of bits? We know we can divide our image up into pixels and that each pixel has a single color or it's transparent. For now, we'll just treat transparency as its own special color. Let's start at the top left, work across and down, listing off the colors of each pixel. Then, we can represent each color as a single number by finding the appropriate amount of red, green, and blue in the color. For reasons you'll find out later, we treat each color as a 5-bit number ranging from 0 to 31. If we do this for each pixel, we'll end up with 512 bytes that correspond to an approximation of this image. I say approximation because we may have lost some color data when we limited our color space from 0 to 255 to 0 to 31. But this works. We can retrieve our image just by reversing the process, going from a byte stream to a two-dimensional image as long as we know what the size of our original image was. What we have done here is called direct color. The graphics data holds the color of each pixel within it without having to do any extra work. The only problem is that this file we made is very large. You can tell just by looking at it that there's a lot of repetition since we use the same colors a lot. Maybe instead of storing the color of each pixel in the file, we store which color it is, and then make a list of all the colors to reference. We'll call transparency number 0, black number 1, white number 2, and so on. Separately, we'll keep track of which color is which number. Without it, we wouldn't be able to restore the correct colors of the image. This is called indirect color, and it's what most of SNES graphics formats use. Another benefit to this format is that we can switch our color table, the palette, and create a copy of the graphics with a different color scheme. To learn how the data is truly stored in memory, let's use a more simpler image for now. This image only has two colors, black and white, so our color indices are just 0 and 1. This is already in binary, so we just start at the top left, work our way across and down to form our file. We used 1 bit to encode each pixel, so we say that this file has a depth of 1 bit per pixel, or 1 BPP. If we step up to 2 bits per pixel, we find that we can expand our palette to be 4 colors instead of 2, and our indices run from 0 to 3. This is the lowest depth that the SNES supports, and it always treats color number 0 as transparent. But there's a small catch. The 2 bits per pixel aren't stored together in memory. There's this thing you have to keep in mind that's called a bit plane. The nth bit plane is the nth bit of each index for each pixel. So the first bit plane is the least significant bit of each index, and the second bit plane is the most significant bit. To store this image in the SNES's 2BPP format, we take the first bit plane, then the second bit plane of each row. Then we add on each row until we get to the last row. There are other ways to store graphics in a 2BPP format, but this is just how the SNES interprets its graphics. The next depth the SNES reads is 4BPP. This allows for 16 colors, since each pixel uses a 4-bit index. We interleave the first and second bit planes like we did for the 2BPP image, then we interleave the third and fourth bit planes. We can also continue this pattern for 8BPP images, which allow for 256 colors. There's another 8BPP format the SNES recognizes, used with its Mode 7 graphics. 8 bits per pixel is also just 1 byte per pixel, so we can just store the pixel indices directly one after the other. This makes more intuitive sense, but it isn't really expandable, which is why the other formats don't use this method. 8BPP graphics can also be stored in direct color format when a certain switch is set. The downfall to using direct color is that you're limited to an 8-bit or an 11-bit color space instead of a 15-bit color space. We did all these examples with an 8x8 pixel tile, but what if we had more graphics than that? 8x8 tiles are stored one after the other. Two tiles will never combine or interleave data. Generally, tiles are organized in rows of 16 due to how objects and 16x16 characters work, but you can really interpret the data however it applies to the situation. So now, we know how the graphics are stored, but we still have the color data to deal with. You'll notice the highest color depth supported up to 256 simultaneous colors. That just happens to be how many colors the SNES can hold in its CG RAM at one time. The colors are stored in the same 15-bit format I showed earlier. A palette is the sequence of colors used to color in a particular graphic, according to the color indices. Palettes can be 4, 16, or 256 colors depending on the bit depth of the graphics themselves. The first color of the palette is always treated as transparent and can't be changed, even if the tile doesn't have any transparency. The first color in CG RAM, color number 00, is used as the background color behind everything. So now, given a dump of CG RAM, which holds all the colors, and a dump of VRAM, which holds all the graphics, you should be able to figure out what the graphics look like. You can use an emulator's debug tools, such as BizHawk or NoCache SNS, to look at the RAM and graphical representations of the RAM in real time, if you're curious. Thank you for watching. This series of videos aims to introduce various things and explain them on a basic level. There are a lot of details that may not find their way into these videos, so I encourage you to do more research on your own if you are seriously interested in this sort of stuff. Next time, we'll talk about objects and OAM.